Thank you. My name is Russ Pavlicek. I have a big mouth and I know how to use it. So therefore, I am the evangelist for Zen Project. One of the rules of public speaking is you never start with an apology, so I'm going to start with two. First off, my Linux laptop did a meltdown on the weekend, so I'm sitting up here with a Windows laptop at an open source conference. Having a Windows laptop at an open source conference makes about as much sense as the phrase voluntary root canal. The second one is that this presentation was designed for Linux Foundation Collab Summit a couple weeks ago. It was designed for 50 minutes, and we have roughly half that amount of time now. So I'm going to speak fast, and some of the background material we're just going to have to sacrifice. The slides themselves are on zenproject.org. So if you need to go back and look particularly at some of the background material or whatever, it's all there. And you're free to harass me for any questions in the hallway or via email or what have you. A little bit about the latest release of Zen Project 4.4. It was released here in March, product of 8 months' worth of work. And this was the first time that the team decided to try to work in a six-month dev cycle. And they actually came pretty close to that, all things considered. And especially since, you know, you had Christmas and New Year's and little human things getting in the way of a development cycle, it actually worked out very well. This section, I'm just going to go very quickly through. How many people here use Zen? Show of hands. Pretty good. How many people have some basic knowledge of Zen? A little bit more. I will make this really, really quick. This is your basic type 1 hypervisor going by the book. We see that we've got the host hardware on the bottom, the hypervisor layer sitting on top, and VMs sitting happily above. Here's a type 2 or a hosted style, where we see that rather than having a straight hypervisor layer, we have a host OS, which has the hypervisor capabilities embedded into it. So the flow is a little different and so forth. Zen Project is type 1 with a twist. That is, it looks, this is your textbook type 1. This is what Zen looks like. And you notice it's almost the same, except largely for the device drivers and models. Well, where do they reside? They reside in what we refer to as a control domain, which solves a whole bunch of problems, especially when it comes to issues regarding security, throughput, and other things. But also, how many people have been working with Linux long enough to remember the old days, maybe back in the 90s, when you went out and you bought a nice little piece of hardware, and you were all excited, and you came back, and you shoved it into your machine, you turned it on, no driver. And then you went ahead and go fish around, see if you needed to upgrade something, if you could find something out on fresh meat or whatever, and try to rebuild the driver, rebuild the kernel, whatever it took to make it work. By having all the drivers and models residing within the control domain, we eliminate that entirely. Basically, if your control domain can talk to the hardware, the hypervisor can talk to the hardware. That's about the size of it. So we solve problems by doing it that way. So that's basically what Zen itself looks like. The basic concepts I've gone over just a little bit here. The control domain is the home for the tool stack. It allows you to speak with the console. And then we have a thing called driver or stub or service domains, which we will only lightly discuss inside this talk, so I'm not going to spend much time there for the sake of time. Okay, to the meat and potatoes, 4.4. What's new in 4.4? One of the big things that changed in 4.4 was improved event channel scalability. Now, what's an event channel? Event channels are paravirtualized interrupts. And we had limits of 1024 or 4096. And that meant practically that you could get maybe 300 to 500 VMs on a host. Well, if we were talking about virtualization a couple years ago, that would sound pretty good, 300 to 500 VMs. That was pretty healthy. But things have changed inside the landscape, especially in the last year or so. And we're beginning to see the rise of these small, ultra-small, tiny VMs, things that are powered by, like, Mirage OS. How many people are aware of Mirage? Okay, a few. How many people have heard of OSV? few more. Things of this sort, they are very small application-centric operating systems that are not full timeshare systems. They don't have tons and tons of drivers to work with hardware because they're supposed to live in a VM. So they're small, lightweight, fast, interesting things. But you need lots of them to make, to give yourself a real healthy farm. And so with these ultra small VMs, you could be looking at 1,000, 2,000 potentially VMs residing on a single host. Well, suddenly event channel size becomes an issue here. Inside this release, we have a new FIFO-based event channel. So now we can have over 100,000 event channels, scalability up into the thousands potentially. There's a bunch of the cloud operating systems called out here, Mirage OS, Erlang on Xen is another one, HalVM and OSV. Interesting stuff. And especially anyone working inside the cloud area, as you all are, become aware. You know, there's interesting stuff coming down the pipe. Also, VDI applications. If you're doing things where you're going to be having multiple graphic presence on one machine, having many event channels can be very, very helpful. So that was one big benefit in 4.4.4. Is removing that limit. Another, this one's a huge one in my mind, is now we're up to experimental PVH guest support. How many people know the difference between paravirtualization and hardware virtualization? Show of hands. Most, for the most part, but. PVH is a variant on paravirtualization, and we'll go into this just a little bit here in just the next minute or two, that allows us to work with greater efficiency, which means better throughput, better speed, all sorts of good things going on, very simple to enable. It's still in the experimental stage, meaning that it runs pretty well. It still has some performance things that are being worked out, probably within the next release, 4.5, from what I've heard. Hopefully, most of the performance models will be up to snuff. So let's just do a very quick background here about Xen modes, because it's actually really important. And just as a sidelight, I've heard more comments about Xen not having good performance. And quite honestly, I'd like to see what they're comparing to, because Xen Project now has four different modes. The two classic ones, the ones that most people know, are power virtualization and hardware virtualization. They are also basically two of the least optimal. Hardware virtualization, we know this, that's you make the virtual machine look like a piece of hardware. So if you want to talk to the network, you have to talk to a driver that looks like a network driver talking to a piece of network hardware. So that means you have to go through the nonsense of packing it all up into some shape so that this supposed piece of hardware can then move it down the pipe. Well, it's all software anyway. So that's a little slow doing that. Paravirtualization was something that Xen Project pioneered back in its infancy, was the notion of rather than trying to replicate hardware, we'll just open basically a big old pipe for data. And if you want to throw something on the network, you just kind of throw it down the pipe. You don't bother formatting it up with all sorts of weird stuff for a piece of hardware that doesn't exist. You just throw it down the pipe, and something on the back end catches it and sends it on, knows what to do. Paravirtualization was really neat, except that the guest OS had to be aware of it. That's really good for Linux, it's really good for the BSDs, not so good for things like Windows. So that's why we have the split between the paravirtualization and the hardware virtualization. So for things like Windows, we could hardware virtualize. For other things, we could paravirtualize and get a bit better performance. But we don't stop there. There has been this need to improve performance even more. The first was called PVHVM. And this was actually using the PV drivers within a hardware virtualization context. The concept is actually relatively straightforward, despite the mind bleed that it can cause when you're reading a slide like this. That we've got these nice pipes in the PV system to throw data down efficiently and quickly. What if we build driver systems within the HVM so that it looks like a simple hardware device that you don't have to work so hard with? You throw it into that driver and it comes out and uses the efficient PV backend. So that was an increase in performance. But the new one is PVH. And PVH is PV in an HVM container. So this is the thought that let's get the optimal solution here. PV is very, very fast for a lot of things, but not everything. So let's try to use PV where PV is fastest, and let's try to use an HVM container for the areas where it's not fastest. So the result is something that, when it's done, when it's fully cooked, probably in 4.5, should be the fastest mode yet for a Zen project. OK, iChart. Hold with me. No aneurysms, please. We're going to get to this in about 30 seconds. It'll make a whole lot more sense. This is the map of how each thing works out, where it's the power virtualization, where is the virtualization and software virtualization and hardware. Now, if I go and color it, green is good. Yellow is could be better. Red is not good. Now you see what has happened here. We started with fully virtualized, which had some things that were bad, some things which were and one thing that was OK. Fully power virtualized was pretty good, but it still had room for improvement. So what we've done with PVHVM is we've drawn this thing down to its ultimate situation for a fully virtualized machine. And with PVH, we've drawn PV up to its ultimate state. So this is the idea, to get this so this is the best possible performance that we can yield. And that's why PVH is so very, very interesting. Like I said, it's not quite to the point where every last part of every benchmark is showing the numbers we want to see. I was talking with Mukesh, who is the engineer who's been working on this a lot. And he's hoping that by the time 4.5 comes around, we will see extremely solid numbers coming out of PVH. So PVH is going to be something well worth watching. What else do we have? We have improved disk driver domains. The bottom line here is that we had some drivers for disk drivers for some things like Linux working one way and other things like Windows working another way. This is now consistent across the board. We've replaced the reliance on UDEV events, and now we've got a much more sound, much more consistent, better throughput situation. And it does allow for extra capabilities, like the ability to use QDisk backends, which weren't possible. So this is a very important feature as well for in terms of flexibility. SPICE, how many people are running SPICE? Probably in a KVM environment, more than likely. It's one of those protocols that's out there that KVM people use from time to time. We actually had some people that said, well, we'd like to be able to use it here too. Why? Because they want a single pane of glass, a single dashboard, a single way to look into their whole virtualization complex, whether it's KVM or Zen. So it's here. If this is something that's important to you, potentially, the capability is here. So now we've got yet another option for you for your virtual desktop display. Grub. We used to have, we still do have, something called PV Grub, which is a grub-like thing that works in the power virtualized world. We've managed to reconcile that with the actual Grub2 structures out there. So now that will be entirely consistent. PV Grub will be entirely consistent with Grub2, starting probably with the next Grub2 release, we think. It's up to the Grub2 team. But 2.02 looks likely for this to come through. This will be a nice shot in the arm for consistency across the board. Indirect descriptors for block PV protocol. Doesn't that sound exciting? Bottom line here is that we're living in an era of big data, big pipes, and a need to move lots of things. What we've done is we have a situation now where we can move it and move it more efficiently than we ever have before. Better throughput, better performance, really helpful for things like, you know, RAID and so forth. So as you are being pressed to do more and more and shove more and more data down the pipe, we can now handle this. It's really, once again, really important as far as the performance aspect goes. And this is coming in through partially through Linux itself. So if you're up to 3.11 or higher in the Linux world, you're going to do OK here. And that's actually now regardless of which version of Zen project you're actually running. KExec support. How many people? Anyone attend our Zen Project User Summit last year? OK. We had a very interesting talk from Greg KH, talking about the work he was doing with KExec. Unfortunately, it wasn't finished at the time that he did the talk. So he said, this is the way it's going to be when I get it done. It's now done. It's an interesting concept, mostly for debugging, but allows us to actually swap in something without rebooting. So for debugging purposes, if there's been a problem with the hypervisor, there's been a problem with a domain zero crash, we can now use KExec to actually start something and look at the state. Not practical for day-to-day stuff, but if you're really trying to find out what went wrong, exceptionally useful. So that's one of the things that's in the toolkit. You see the versions there. I won't worry about that too much. Zappy. How many people know what Zappy is? Good. Zappy, we have three basic toolkits in Zen. And people say, well, why do you have three basic toolkits? Well, partially because we're trying to give you what you need to get the job done. And each one has a different look. It has a different aspect. We have XM, which has now been supplanted by Zen Lite or XL. That's sort of the basic one-host Zen Pure way of manipulating the world. There is a second one, of course, is Libvirt. And anyone who's worked with KVM is aware of Libvirt. Libvirt was supposed to be, from its foundation, supposed to be a hypervisor agnostic. Well, things kind of fell out of sync between Zen Project and Libvirt. We are now working very hard to bring that back into sync. So if you're doing a lot of stuff in the Libvirt world, you'll be better off than you ever were before. You'll be able to speak the one common language. However, one of the best things I think about Zen, and we see this a lot in the Zen server world, is Zappy. And Zappy is sort of the cloud layer within the Zen world, because it allows you to do very cloudish things. Now, Zappy and things like the Mirage OS, which I said is one of those cloud operating systems, very small, lightweight, they're both sub-projects of Zen Project itself. They're written in OCaml. How many people are OCaml experts? Okay, now we see where people work in their day job. That's one of those things that's quite interesting to most people. But those OCaml bindings are really important for performance. And a lot of work has gone into that overall. This means, once again, better throughput, better performance, and better compatibility going forward. Nested virtualization, the talk, if you were in the talk just before this, there was a very interesting use case of nested virtualization to do all sorts of cloud stack testing inside one area. Zen now has a tech preview of a nested virtualization capability. Not ready to go to press with. I mean, this is not production ready, but it does work. And it's enough that you can play with it. You can test with it, and so forth. Very, very interesting. So now you can run Zen within Zen, or you can run VMware within Zen, or Hyper-V within Zen, or KVM. So it gives you that ability to put a cloud in a box for testing purposes. Very interesting, perhaps, for the cloud stack people. This is the type of thing that allows you, as developers, to do a lot with a little and to do basic testing without having tons of hardware laying around or having to necessarily go out onto the internet to get stuff done. So this has a lot of great possibilities. It enables very easily, as you see here, and there's a link that talks about how the Nested Zen stuff works. As I said before, the slides are all up on zenproject.org, so you don't have to worry about hurrying up and copying down URLs. EFI booting, secure boot. You know, that's something that's really important in the Windows world and getting to be more important inside other areas. And we now have experimental support for that as well on the guest level. So once again, if that's the way your organization is rolling, or if you're working, trying to put together a product that you want to have that as a capability, we now have that in motion in Zen Project as well. Gluster FS. How many people work with Gluster? Okay, one or two. This is one of the interesting things, because actually this is no change at all. But the change here is basically one of mindset. We actually spent some time working with the Gluster people, and they said, well, you know, you can use Gluster within a Zen Project install pretty easily. And so they put together this page, which just shows you how to do the configuration. It's basically setting it up as an iSCSI target, and it's pretty straightforward overall. But it allows you, if you're looking into Gluster as something that you want to work with, you know, we can play there too. It's not difficult. One thing that I've just mentioned too at this point, you know, I do a lot of talking about Zen Project, and one of the questions I get frequently is, what's the difference between Zen Project and some of the commercial hypervisors out there? Well, one of the big things that I see is that we work from a very different frame of mind. Being an open source project, we want to be there to provide you the hypervisor services that you need. We don't want to tell you what your cloud looks like. We don't want to tell you what your service model looks like. When you've made a decision that you're going to do something, you're going to implement CloudStack, you're going to implement something else, we want to give you the service that you need. Unfortunately, some of the more commercial entities out there have a nasty habit of handing you the hypervisor and then telling you what the cloud's going to look like. And they want you to use their cloud, their cookbook, their this, their that. And if you try to go off the farm, it becomes, you know, painful at times. So that's one of the big things here, is that we are always open for that integration layer. We're always open to try to make links to other products, projects, whatever it is that you need to do. Here's another huge one. How many people are actually looking at ARM as a future technology around here? Okay, it is actually one of the things that is getting some remarkable mileage, both on the server side and on the not server side. And there's been a tremendous amount of work for Zen Project on ARM. And one of the interesting things is that the ARM hypervisor layer that came out with ARM v7, I believe, inside their specs, looks basically just like the Zen virtual environment. It maps hand in glove. It's a very, very tight story. So we stay exactly within the hypervisor mode within the ARM architecture. It allows for a very clean implementation. So we already have done quite a bit in the ARM area, and we see a lot of this in 4.4. There's stability improvements, PSCI support, a number of different things that are going on there. And there's more to come. As well, we're seeing some of these other things. You know, I won't read through every last bit here because for the sake of time. But we are trying to meet the need where it is. You know, it's interesting. One of the things at our Zen Project Developer Summit last year, someone was talking about putting Zen on a phone. And people are saying, Zen on a phone? Why would you want a hypervisor on a phone? Well, how many people have, you know, have their own smartphone that they use for work? Show of hands. Now, how many people work in an organization that say, okay, this is great, you can get your email on your phone, but when you leave this organization, we're going to issue the wipe command. And the picture of your wife, your kid, your dog, your Aunt Martha, all gone. And someone said, you know what? If we had a hypervisor on a phone, we could have an instance that is me, my person, and another instance, me, corporate citizen. And so when the wipe comes, corporate citizen goes away, but the picture of the wife, the kids, and the dog, all intact. I don't have to give up anything. Here's some more of the armed support. I'm getting the 3-minute call, so I'm going to go quickly through the rest of this. Early microcode loading. If that makes sense to you, you're excited. If not, I'm not going to bother with it for you. A little bit on futures. Some of the futures are really astounding. One is the whole Zen Automotive. One of the other things that came out of Developer Summit last year was that people are using Zen Hypervisor in a car in the entertainment session, in the entertainment system. Once again, we want to meet you where your need is. They've come up with a really novel way of dealing with it. We've got more ARM support. We've got virtual GPU support, Zen GT. Really interesting stuff that's coming at this point from mostly from the Intel side, but there's a lot of interesting things to come. More PVH stability and better performance coming. Support of VMware VMDK files. We expect that to show up hopefully in the next release. Better integration both with distributions and with cloud orchestrations like CloudStack, et cetera. Better NUMA performance, that's a big one for us as well. As I said, better libvirt support. We've got a testing system that we're building that will be a public test so that if you're doing stuff with Zen, you'll be able to fit it right in and not have to have your own massive environment somewhere. And of course, performance enhancements. Last 30 seconds, two major meetings coming up soon, Developer Summit and User Summit. Developer Summit in Chicago, User Summit in New York. CFPs are open for both. If you are an integrator working with Zen, if you are an end user working with Zen, we'd love to hear your story. We'd love to see what you have to say, what you're doing, what you're thinking of, or maybe in the developer world, what you need that we're not giving you. So pitch that, please. Respond to the CFPs, they're open now. You can find the links there on the Zen Project homepage. And I think we are like totally out of time, so I can take questions in the hallway track afterwards and not make the next speaker late.
Thanks a lot, Russell.
Thank you.